Thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting me to this very important forum. I must admit and regret the fact that I have not been part of the whole discussion right from the beginning till the end. But nevertheless, I had my moles there at the seminar all throughout, and I am very well aware of what has been discussed. And in fact, I heard about the very important recommendation that came through from three groups. And in fact, before I get into my formal remarks, let me just first tackle with the recommendation that they came through from the three groups. Starting from group three, they talked about climate fund. It's a very good idea. However, you know, the starting point is, and I'm going to mix up now the recommendation of all the three groups and recommend that we should work in a very focused fashion to make sure that the delivery on climate finance is indeed ensured. So while, you know, it's a great idea to have climate fund, it's a great idea to have capacity development for non-grant related financing, as Group 1 suggested. However, the starting point would be what, and that's my favorite topic in fact, the starting point should be to get the taxonomy going. Without taxonomy, no funding pockets or better coordination, as the Group 2 talked about in detail, which is imperative, would work. So the starting point is to get the taxonomy going, putting all the projects both at the provincial level and the federal government level, as well as the private sector, under one taxonomy, and then take it on from there. I think that is the starting point and the most important aspect to my mind. And then, as a secondary piece, and I think equally important, is the fact is to get the legislations aligned, which the Group 3 talked about, as well as the Group 2 talked about. The alignment of the of the legislation, and a sub part to that is the better coordination necessary between provincial and federal government. And an authority perhaps is necessary where the representation from the provinces is also important to get going in a more cohesive manner to pursue climate financing in Pakistan. And third, and the most important piece, of course, and this has been highlighted again today as well, is the capacity building overall from the development of the project, the products as such, climate financing products, but the evaluation of the climate projects as well, and then making the whole proposition bankable. So in broader terms, the recommendation, the three groups that have come through, if I were to sort of box them in more focused fashion, then this is the sequence and these are the three things that I would recommend that we should pursue and take it on from there. So as we wrap up today's consultation workshop on Pakistan's National Climate Finance Strategy, I want to express my heartfelt thanks for your valuable contributions. Your active engagement and insightful discussion have made this a truly productive session in my opinion. Today, we have made significant strides towards developing a robust climate finance strategy, which is very much evident from the three recommendations that have come through in the working groups. But the challenges are substantial. Pakistan needs approximately $348 billion for climate action by 2030. Today's discussion have illuminated paths of solutions, particularly through cross-sector collaboration. Bilal Anwar's stark reminder of the current climate crisis is pertinent to note. Carbon dioxide levels have reached unprecedented heights, triggering extreme weather events and accelerating biodiversity loss at rates never witnessed before. The erratic and multi-factorial nature of climate change complicates adoption efforts underscoring the urgent necessity for a comprehensive climate finance framework that acknowledges the principle of common but differentiated responsibilities established in international climate agreements. Despite witnessing a substantial increase in climate financing, rising at an estimated $1.3 trillion globally between 2021 and 2022, a doubling from 2019, Pakistan faces critical barriers in accessing and effectively mobilizing these funds. The current financial landscape is marred by complexities and procedural obstacles, particularly impacting vulnerable sectors and SMEs that play a pivotal role in sustainable development. Bilal Ahmed Saab's urging of stakeholders to cultivate an enabling environment through robust policy frameworks, transparent governance structures, and technological advancements that enhance the flow of climate finance is the crux of what is required. My dear friend, Ali Taqir Sheikh Saab further elaborated on the challenges inhibiting the scaling of climate finance incentives initiatives in Pakistan. I know how Ali is passionate about the whole subject, and frankly, although my mole was here, but even if he was not here, I would have known what, you know, Ali would have advocated about today. He emphasized that many existing sectoral policies that lack adequate climate proofing and prioritization, which undermines their effectiveness. Ali advocated for a holistic whole of government approach to clarify responsibilities across ministries and ensure that climate finance initiatives are seamlessly integrated into national economic strategies. This integration is vital for aligning national priorities with international climate commitments. As Sheikh Saab also highlighted, perhaps the most pressing need and disparity exists in data collection on climate risk and vulnerabilities. Establishing a centralized climate data repository such as the CACIP, Central Asian Climate Information Platform, which is aimed to help stakeholders to access, analyze, and visualize public domain data, would not only improve project feasibility but also bolster investment attractiveness by providing critical insights for potential investors. And that's what has come out in the discussion of the working groups too, and in my opinion seems to be the most important in the urgent matter that needs to be taken on and addressed in the form of taxonomy that we talked about. As we all are aware, existing high investment risk compounded by political landscape and a weak regulatory framework deters private sector participation in climate initiatives. Now that's a big challenge, and you know, I must admit that the banks have to be blamed for it too. Nevertheless, the recommendation which has come out today will probably help the banks to bring up their skill set to move towards climate financing in a more structured fashion. Just to share with you all that State Bank of Pakistan has already introduced the green financing policy, whereby, you know, by force we have been asked to develop our skill set and start evaluating this as a risk in our credit approvals. Now that is a major step forward, and that I'm sure will help in improving the climate financing options and force the banks to develop the products which are necessary for climate financing. Implementing a green taxonomy is essential for enhancing Pakistan's capital finance strategy by establishing a standard framework for classifying sustainable investments. This clarity will help attract domestic and international investors, ensuring funds are directed towards verifiable green projects while mitigating the risk of greenwashing. Aligning Pakistan's taxonomy with global standards such as those used in Europe and ASEAN can boost foreign climate finance accessibility and credibility, facilitating access to resources like the Green Climate Fund. Moreover, this framework can support carbon pricing mechanisms by identifying sectors eligible for carbon credits, which would help develop a carbon trading system similar to Europe's. A robust green taxonomy will also foster policy coherence across critical sectors such as energy, agriculture and transportation, ensuring consistent achievement of global goals while enhancing transparency and reducing risk associated with funding. Targeting specific, sector-specific taxonomy, which somebody has already talked about in the group as well, areas like agriculture, energy will facilitate more effective investments in adopting and mitigating strategies. Moreover, one of the significant challenges facing Pakistan is the lack of bankable climate-related projects, which often lack feasibility studies, financial models, and risk assessment that are essential to attract private sector investment. To address these challenges, it is crucial to conduct thorough risk assessment and vulnerability mapping, to identify climate hazards, quantify economic impact, and inform investment decisions. All of this will now become part of the risk assessment framework that the State Bank of Pakistan introduced.